Hey everybody, this is JTB.
And this is Bigalski.
And we're back for chapter 6 in the normal Karma Run tutorial video. Forewarning, you might want to get some food and be comfortable. This is a long one. This is a long chapter, and there's no edits, so there's a lot of stuff here. This is just some important information.
Oh, nice. So I got my drink.
right here, we've mentioned this before, but in chapter 6 in NGO4 and HP1, there's a couple of fights. Actually, I'm not sure if it's in HP1. I'd have to check. But in NGO4, for definite, there's a couple of fights that aren't timed in black, but they are in NGO4. And they weren't taken off the kill bonus in Chapter 6. So you will be killing a couple of enemies to chain essence throughout. So they will add on. But I highly recommend, once you get before going down into the underground, mock run the rest of the chapter so you know exactly how many kills you need. It's usually going to end up at 5 or 6. Personally, I always prefer to kill 6 just so it's, you know you're not going to miss it. But definitely don't forget to farm those kills, otherwise you'll fail the kill bonus at the end of the chapter and you won't have time to go back after you go underground. So then, you'll just kind of back yourself into a corner there. And that's pretty much it regarding the fights. There is some stuff in here you can leave in Chapter 7. You can leave the archive challenge if you want, but I put it at the beginning, like, you should do it in this chapter. You know, the kills are allocated to this chapter, so you should do it in this chapter, really, on a Karma run.
And really the time, too.
Yeah, exactly.
And not only the kills and the time.
It's more of a thing on the higher difficulties, really, because on the higher difficulties, you do actually have the time to kind of play around with the fiend challenges if you really want to. But you should really do them, in the chapter that they're allocated in.
Yeah, because you're going to be making up kills if you don't do it, so you might as well just go ahead and do it.
Yeah, exactly. So this chapter, I can't remember what the gauntlet section said, but I did mention about the monk fiends. That's kind of your one thing you'll notice, to spoil it, but this chapter runs the time limit super, super close. It's very, very tight. I didn't envision it being that close, but the reason I kind of did it that way is because I wanted to try and break up these monk fiend encounters as much as possible. And really, in theory, you could kind of trim some fights here, really. You could do these first couple, back to back if you really wanted to. But it's mainly the monk fights in the monastery that you never really want to end up doing, like, more than two at a time, because they're just so unpredictable. There's no real way to control their spawns. Sometimes in some of the encounters, they'll just spawn at the absolute opposite end of the area from where you are, and if you have, minimal time left and they spawn, completely far away, like, you're done. Like, you're going to fail the time bonus. So that's why I kind of break this chapter up the way I do.
Now, at the beginning of the chapter by the save statue, on the higher difficulties, if you go back out to the Hydrocubus area, there is a timed encounter there, mm-hmm. but on normal, there's not.
Yeah, it's frustrating that. That is annoying, because it's annoying having to farm kills. It's one of the things that's so easy to forget on, like, Ninja Dog, for example. you can have a really good chapter and then think, oh, crap, I need to farm, like, an extra 20-odd kills with fiend challenges. Now, these fights right here, you can definitely get a UT and an ET, but oddly enough, these brown imps, because they're not that aggressive, they can be awkward to play for points, because they love to duck underground and just kind of hang back and not really do anything and, cause you to whiff, and it's just really frustrating when that happens.
See, that's where I go farm my kills. I go back outside. I leave that essence, and I go back out the gate. Those imps will respawn, kill the three, go back out, come back in. They'll respawn. I do it 3 times, actually.
Yeah, so
just
right
here, drag the essence and get it over with.
Yeah, so this is where the fun starts. This fight right here. Oh, man, this is annoying. There's a round. I had a lot of practice runs at this. That was very lucky. And there's around 7 to 8 ways this fight can open, and only one of them is the one you want. So, a lot can go wrong at the start of this, and you have another fight to do after this. And it's just really frustrating. There is a sweet spot you can use here, where Ryu is now, where he's actually facing up and to the left. There's a little bit near the the altar, I guess. And you can, stand in there, and they'll just kind of stand outside, and you can just UT them. Unfortunately, on normal, you just don't have the time to really just stand there and, charge UTs over and over again. You could get a couple of quick ones in at the start and then kill these guys quickly, but overall, you'd miss out on UTs, because you can still kill two at a time, and you'll be okay.
Right. and you want to drag that essence into here. I mean, you could make it easier and go save if you got that like you wanted, but then you don't have the essence to drag in here, so you're already starting out, you know, down either a UT or an ET.
You're already down on points. And again, like, this chapter is kind of went up on my tier list, I suppose, of hot chapters to karma on normal. I'd put this right on par with chapter 4 now. Like, this is really tough to get. I mean even here, like, this looks pretty good, but you know, there's definitely missed points here, you know. Definitely any time like this, for example, I'm finishing with, you know, probably what, like about 5-6 seconds here,
right?
You know, that's a lot of points missed. You know, that's an ET almost, or maybe a UT if you can get lucky. I mean, yeah, look at that, almost 5 seconds left on the clock, you know. So, right. In theory, that 5 seconds should be points, not time left on the clock. But that was okay. That's why I mentioned about picking up the nunchucks in Chapter 4. Again, you could use the Dragon Sword, or you could use the Luna to kill, you know, one guy and leave the last one alive. But if they come at you both at the same time, with the Luna, you're definitely going to kill both on normal. With the Dragon Sword, there's a very high chance you'll kill both. The good thing about the nunchucks is that starting move where he dashes out, then that's got a really nice amount of travel time, so it pushes them far away, and then you can keep it on them. And, you know, as long as you make sure that last hit connects on the same guy, like, you're relatively safe there with killing. It's not 100%. Sometimes they can just jump right into the UT, which is annoying. But the nunchucks do make that pretty consistent.
Now, did you go and save at all during any of this?
Nope.
Oh, wow.
You definitely could save after this fight. Not after this one, sorry. After the one before it. Because you're not chaining essence to this fight. But this is pretty rough. Like, 3 monk fights in a row, like, is probably more than it needs to be. But the next fight coming up and the one after that, that's where, like, a good chunk of points are. So, you know, I wanted to get that really good, as opposed to trying to get 3 monk fights in a row really good. As the last one's not worth that many points. This is me almost forgetting the Devil Elixir. Do not forget that.
I might have actually went ahead while I was up on that top, went over and got the Devil Elixir and the Scarab.
I'd do that here instead.
Yeah, that way it's already done while I was already up there. Because I always end up falling off anyway a couple times. It's so sad.
It is frustrating when you fall off that. Yeah, that's true. I knew I was forgetting something in the edits. It was to put that wooden sword upgrade in there. I'll go back and do that before the video's up. But make sure you do that. That's actually a very, very important upgrade. I think on the no reset run I did, I just get all my money in chapter 9. And that's a big difference on a reset run, because on a reset run, saving in chapter 9 actually costs you a lot of time. You don't have anywhere near the amount of time to farm money on a reset run. So you want to try and stagger a couple of the, you know, relatively expensive wooden sword upgrades in these chapters, so that once you get to chapter 8 and chapter 9, you can actually manage your essence and get the UF before the electric worm in chapter 10.
There's a lot of planning that goes into this. It's not willy-nilly, you know. You really got to think about it if you want to really improve your score.
There is.
See, I would have done that earlier while I was already up there.
There is, and the frustrating thing is that you can very easily forget something in chapter 4 that doesn't come back to bite you in the arse until chapter 10. You know, it's very easy to do that. You might not think that, you know, that early in the game will affect later in the game, you know, but it does.
Right, oh yeah, yeah.
Like forgetting to pick up the deity here.
Right. I do that before I even go to the safe.
Only an idiot would do that. So this fight, again, this is really annoying. There's tons of different ways this fight can open. Sometimes they will just let you charge a full UT there, which is, of course, what you want. Sometimes they don't. The monk spawns in this encounter in particular are really annoying. This long hallway bit where they are, like, they love to just teleport back and forth like he did there, completely nowhere near you. So it's a good job that imp spawned there, otherwise that UT wouldn't have hit anything.
So
was supposed to be a flying swallow, but whatever. Getting hit by the monks there is actually better, as it's a quicker recovery. You can actually get out of it. But using Inferno here just to take out the monks, more often than not, they do tend to give you blue orbs, so you can get a... The reason I threw the windmill there is so I didn't get an accidental warkling, always keep that stuff in mind because I'd staggered that essence with Inferno. Like, I knew they were going to come out at different times, so I could get that in. So just, you know, keep that stuff in the back of your mind. So, like, right there, like, he just dodges that incendiary and he jumps the other side.
Now, again, for beginners on this, JTB is leaving his, you're leaving your lunar at level one throughout the whole
run, right? Yeah, definitely. Yeah,
but if you don't feel comfortable doing that and just want to get through it and get a few karma runs under your belt, you could always upgrade your weapons, get a feel of it all.
I would recommend doing that, to be honest. On, you know, if it's your first karma run, the level one lunar UT with the armlet of the sun on, 9 times out of 10, will kill a monk fiend every time. Like, if all of it hits, it should kill them. However, this being NG, sometimes that doesn't happen.
Right, which is very annoying. Yeah.
So,
you never know what you're gonna get.
So right here, that unusually, what I said about the imps not being that aggressive, funnily enough, he was there, but still with the nunchucks, I'm able to get that extra ET I wanted, and it's funny how, like, that does no damage, and yet as soon as the last hit connects, like, he's done for. Like, it's it's such a weak UT, but that last hit is just, it's so powerful. So yeah, I mean, that was an okay run of those fights. I really don't enjoy the Monk Fiends. They're super frustrating. One of the nice things about this chapter on Very Hard Master Ninja is you've just got so much time. You've got so much time to save after these fights. You know, doing these fights back-to-back is a huge pain.
Oh, yeah.
So this is a very important Muramasa visit. Fun fact, I actually screwed up the entire run of this because I forgot to record this segment. And I did the archive challenge, got down to the underground segment, and then I realized I'd forgot to stick this part in. So I went back and recorded it, but I think I left the game running while I went and did something, and then I thought, oh, it doesn't matter because I'm not using that save. So I went and saved, and of course that added to my clock. And then I realized that after the archive challenge and thought, oh shit, like, so I had to do the archive challenge again, which was a bit annoying.
I don't know why he runs up the side of the wall there or something.
Yeah, me neither. It is an odd one. I did that because I wanted this series to not, you know, I really didn't want it to miss anything, you know, like what I'm buying. It all matters, you know, it's all important information. And if you don't know what to look for, it can really blow back on you. So the archive challenge is fairly straightforward, but there is another way I did find having a go at this. If I end up doing a proper run, I might actually, like, really put some time in. But if you stay on the stairs where you come in here, because of the angle that those stairs are at, there's a really, really high chance that every single attack the imps do, apart from their, like, jumping overhead smash, it just whiffs completely. Because they slide down the stairs during the startup frames of their attack, and it just misses you completely. So you can charge, you know, ETs to UTs very easily without smoke bombs. So, you know, if you could hold 50 smoke bombs, it'd be great, but you can only hold 15 at the end of the day.
Right.
So you can do that pretty easily. You can get, like, really quick UTs in with Inferno on the Monk Fiends. But I tried it a couple of times, and it just seemed very inconsistent. Like, it's something you'd really have to grind to get, like, the best run on. And this is a fairly consistent way of getting, you know, a very high amount of UTs. I like staying to the right here. I used to stay to the left where that handrail kind of goes out.
Yeah, the slope.
Yeah, the problem with that is when the Monk Fiends teleport, if they teleport to your right, they can sometimes just stay outside the rail and your UT whiffs completely. Like, you don't get any hits. Whereas here, they tend to teleport right next to you or on top of you. So even if it's only, like, 3 hits there, like, you might not get the whole thing, but you still get some hits of that UT. Like, you really don't want these UTs to whiff.
Right. It's funny. I haven't really experienced that, but it seems really consistent right there. And also using that windmill shirk, and I've seen people try this strategy and then try to attack with the lunar and all of that, but that windmill shuriken really does a lot of damage.
Yeah, it's like usually 2 or 3 hits of that will take them out after 3 hits of the UT. And the thing with the windmill shuriken, you can see it here, the windmill shuriken's recovery is basically tied to when it comes back to Ryu. So if you throw it in open space, you know, it's got all the travel time to come back to him, whereas if you're right next to a wall, you'll throw it, and then it comes back to him immediately because it rebounds off the wall. So it's something I do a lot just because it's funny. But if you get a human enemy and you get him right near a wall, you can just like rapid fire the windmill shuriken at him, and because the hit stun is so long, it just looks really funny. So like right here, that's going to rebound off the wall, look, and I can throw it again like immediately. So that's why I like using that. I did try using incendiaries, but the recovery on just a raw incendiary throw on the ground is so long that you can get hit in that recovery. It's so bad. So that's why I didn't mess around with that. I think there should be 20 monk fiends, if I remember rightly.
And that's the other part of it, too, keeping track of, mm-hmm. How many you've got, and then where do you need to go. And like I said, it's a lot of it. There's a lot to it.
Yeah, so he should give me a blue. Yep, he does. So here I can focus on the imps. Now, this is one example, a very, very rare example, where, funnily enough, it was only because I had to redo this archive challenge that I actually really kind of worked this out, is that the time bonus in this encounter, at least for now, I'm not entirely sure how worth it is to go for it. At the end of this run on my first run of this challenge, I would cut getting UT short at around 90 seconds to try and kill all the imps I had left to kill. To do that, you'd have to kill an imp roughly every 2.5 seconds with ET. So it would literally be, ET, an imp spawns, ET, an imp spawns. You would have to get that, 28 times in a row, which is extremely unlikely that you would get that.
Right.
And you would get, 25 to 30 ETs. ETs are worth 2,000 points apiece. That's, anywhere from, 50 to 60,000 in terms of in-game karma, whereas you'd only have to get 12 UTs in 100 seconds to equal that. And 12 UTs in 100 seconds, if you can average 6 seconds per UT, that gives you, an error of a few seconds. So, and it's more under your control. So it's something that I'll probably mess with a bit more if I ever come back to this. But for this, I got 200. That's right there. Look, they just fall down the stairs, which is quite funny.
Oh, nice.
So yeah, it'll definitely take a bit more digging into than that. But I managed to get almost 200k in UT points out of this chapter, and I was super happy with that. So I thought, I'll take it and I'll just move on.
Yeah, that is an interesting way. I don't think this way has ever been shown like that.
Yeah, you can kind of see it here a little bit. If you can save your smoke bombs, especially if you can save your smoke bombs. I had a really good run of this up until about 35 kills, and then everything just went to shit. The monk fiends were just spawning on top of me every single time and knocking me out of my UT. If you can save those smoke bombs until you've taken out the monk fiends, dare say you might be able to get the full 50 UTs here. But that would have to go pretty well. So you've only got, what is it, I think you've got 370 seconds in this fight. The lunar UTs about 4 point, roughly the same time as the dragon swords UT. So if you just do the maths on that, that cuts it pretty fine. That was really cheeky. Well, that was spawning off screen.
Yeah.
This is pretty close. I think I get quite lucky here. So yeah, he does that attack. Any other attack, if he'd have gone underground, I wouldn't have got that last UT there. It would have just whiffed. But here, I'm failing the time bonus. But if you go back and sort of time it from 30 kills and add on the ETs and then count up how many UT points I get, probably evens out. But again, it's something that someone else can mess with maybe.
Well, like I said, it's also new and a new strategy. Instead of the same old thing. So that's the good part about this. And then, who knows, some of the new players that you inspire might come up with another way, too.
Yeah, you never know. There's a few things, even we've touched on it before, but especially in this run, I'm thinking, that's just kind of the way it was always done. Was that the best way? Let's try this way. And who knows? who knows what we'll find?
Now, he didn't put in his life of 1,000 gods, but again, for new players, I would put that in.
Definitely put that in. Although, funnily enough, it's great you mentioned that. If I'd have used the life of 1,000 gods in this chapter, I would have failed my time bonus.
Oh.
literally, I would have failed it if I'd have missed. So here is me farming my kills. At this point, as I said, I've already gone and practice the chapter to see how many kills I need, how many of these guys I need to kill. And with how close I end up cutting this, that blue right there is really bad luck. Because the ET is so much faster, and that UT only kills one guy. So, like, that first ET killed two people, you know, killed two of them. And look how much faster that first volley of kills was compared to the second one.
Right.
So, you know, if you cut it this close, which you probably shouldn't, but if you do, you know, kill those guys with ETs. You know, make it really quick.
And the other part of that, too, is if you're running short on time and don't want to redo the whole chapter, you know, try to finish some fights a lot earlier than you normally would instead of running it down. And, you know, if you save 10 seconds here or 12 seconds there because you finished it early, hey, you'll make your time bonus.
Yeah, exactly.
Versus not doing it or the frustration of having to start over from either the beginning of the chapter or... Because I've had to do that before. Just messed it up so bad to where it's like, you know what, let me just start over.
Yeah, it can easily happen. As I said, it, you know, it's one mistake. It's not saving one encounter. You know, if you say, if you overwrite a save and think, ah, we're fine. And then you find out later, oh, we're not. You gotta do the whole thing again.
I mean, literally every save. That's so good that you can do that. I have a hard time doing that.
Yeah, it's awesome. I forget the name of the person who mentioned this there, but someone posted this on a YouTube video a while ago, and this, funnily enough, is what made me think of this for Ghostfish. Again, a perfect example, you know, getting through Ghostfish like without taking damage, it was Air Destruction Slash, you know, up until this year. You know, it was like, oh, just Air Destruction Slash through them. It's like, nope, on landing jump. It's like, it's way faster, you know? Again, you know, perfect example of how just it's great that people are still following this. You know, we're getting new stuff figured out. So this is a pretty short gauntlet. You could save after this if you wanted to. You could like cut out a save earlier on and save after this. But there's not a ton of points in this fight and the wasp fiends. Like, you know, you're not gonna be losing like three or four UTs. On these fights right here, so this is a pretty mild as far as gauntlets go. One thing to note: when you knock them off the edge like that, it will kill them, but their essence will not spawn. So try not to do that if you can avoid it.
That is a little frustrating.
Yeah,
they drop so far.
Yeah, it's good that it doesn't rob you of the kill, but you need the essence. You know, it's like, damn it. I need that essence. So here, you can just go out and kill those bats and then come in here. These wasp fiends, I would say wasp fiends are absolutely top of the list in terms of worst enemy in the game to play for points.
Oh, you actually hit that guy.
Just fuck these guys. They are so frustrating on a karma run. Fortunately, this goes pretty decent. I was happy to get just like a UT per guy, per two guys rather. I thought if I can get that, you know, I'm fine. Fortunately, I have enough time here where I can actually just charge this and let it go. Always try and wait for them to attack you, though. Again, they love to just fly ever so gradually away from your UT as it whiffs, and then you have to start over.
Ever so gradually.
Yeah. It's like they're just trolling you. So, yeah, or if you have the time, wait for them to start coming towards you before you release your UT.
You're platforming down to that spot was actually really good. I have to kind of adjust, or sometimes I'll hang off the ledge, or I'll miss the ledge and jump down.
Oh, on the wasp fiends, you mean?
Yeah, just there.
Yeah,
I went to the gate to come down, man. It's like, man.
That's just too much. That's doing it too many times. So this fight is actually quite tricky. You don't have a lot of time here, and there's seven of these guys, and these bloody chains in the middle of the floor, they really don't help. You know, the enemies get stuck behind them, your UT, you know, can get stuck on them, Ryu can get stuck like on the, you know, the anchor points on the floor. If those chains weren't in this fight, it really wouldn't be that bad. But they really do make that quite tricky, which is why I like the incendiaries. The incendiaries tend to one-shot the brown imps on normal, which is really nice, as it's just a nice way to stagger essence. You can definitely get more UTs there if you want, but again, this is the start of one of the biggest gauntlets in the game, if not... I think this is tied with Chapter 1. I think this is 8 fights in a row, if I remember rightly.
Yeah, again, because of my save pattern, I usually save after that fight.
Yep. So one thing to note there, it's easy to miss, but when you knock for lack of a better word, squishy enemies onto the floor, so enemies that aren't immune to shurikens, you can throw shurikens at them on the floor to stagger them to charge your essence, like I did just there. And it's just a nice way to make sure that with imps, for example, sometimes they love to stand up and teleport underground, and then your UT whiffs. And if you'd have done that there, like, I'd have had to restart. So if you just use the shurikens, they just give you that little bit of extra stun to then do that. So right here, I XY, but because I'm near the switch, which Ryu loves to target, I swap back to my Luna just in case.
Yeah, it's really smart. Because you think you're going to...
Yep.
He'll release towards that, and you're like, mother...
He loves to do it. Yep, he loves to do it. So it's one good thing about the Luna. Again, it's got a... You know, its UT isn't contingent on actually hitting something. It just goes... again, we have another Wasp Fiend, you know, in a gauntlet, which is great. I think this is pretty close, actually, if I remember rightly. This is one of those fights that, even on a full-blown run, I think to myself, if I make the time limit, I'm happy. Like, I don't,
oh, yeah, exactly.
I don't care. Exactly. Like, you know, I don't, I mean, this is going pretty well, though, here, and I think it just kind of, I think I only kill, yeah, that whiffs, look, that completely misses everybody.
That sucks.
And I get pretty lucky here, that guy comes at me. So I definitely missed a UT there, maybe even two, on a really good run, but it's just really frustrating.
See, and that's the other part about the going back to the archive challenge, how you ran it down past zero versus making the time limit. Hey, you might have got some extra UTs up top, but now it might cost you time to where now you have to go through it, so you might miss out some.
Exactly.
In order to make your chapter bonus.
Exactly. And I mean, you think about it, that archive challenge, I spend, what, maybe an extra 20 seconds in it? Like, not, it's not a massive amount of time. But if I'd have finished this chapter with 20 seconds left, it would have been a lot less stressful than what I end up finishing it with.
Right.
So one thing to note here, it's important to mention it, as it's easy to miss. Take off the armlet of the sun when you're farming zombies. It sounds obvious, but there's a very particular reason for it. Is the Luna UT with armlet of the sun on, when you stun a zombie archer and then UT them, if you do that with armlet of the sun on, odds are that full UT is going to kill them, and you don't want that, because what you can do is you can stun them, kill them with the UT, hit them once so they start dying and their essence starts coming out, and then you can charge up an ET in the amount of time it takes for what is hopefully a blue essence coming out, so then you can get an ET, absorb that UT, get a UT straight away. If you keep armlet of the sun on, you'll kill them and they'll give you a yellow every time.
Right. More little hidden nuggets that people may not think of.
I really hate farming zombies. I really hate it. But I know Balbade, I remember mentioned in one of the forum threads that he loves it. You know,
oh,
it's like you just get loads and loads of points, and I think, oh yeah, but I just you know, I hate it. This is one of the things. If they just gave you, I mean, you've got what, 15 guys here. If they just gave you like 40 seconds, so it was like, right, just go ape shit with the flails, that would be so much better than having to do this.
I remember when I first started the game and going to the boards and people were doing the zombie challenge and they were just saying how frustrating and hard it was, because nobody was really like chaining UTs back when Ninja Gaiden came
out, not really,
because you didn't get any UT points.
And in NGO4, you couldn't charge UTs, you know, from neutral.
Yeah.
You know, you had to have essence. So like the zombies, and that's the funny thing about the zombies, you know, they're slow, but they hit hard, you know, even on normal. You should have a bigger health bar here, but even on normal, like, you know, their grab and their hits, you know, they do a really good chunk of damage to you. So, and it's easy to kind of get pummeled by zombies. You know, they can, it's just like slow zombies in real life, you know, one at a time, they're no problem. But if you get a group of them, they can mess you up.
You're used to the farming of the soldier, so you know how far to go.
Yeah, exactly. Like, that's one thing where, you know, like, you know, kind of knowledge definitely transfers. Farming Eternal Legend, those big purple fiends, they are basically zombies, just, you know, they're just a bigger model. So just adjust your distance slightly for when you're fighting them. One thing to note at the end there, when you have one zombie left with a lot of time, like I did there, as long as you know your positioning, you should be able to get 2 to 3 UTs and an ET out of them. As long as you swap over to the flails or the dragon sword for the final UT, as you need the power to kill them faster. You know, if you was to try and do that with the Luna, they might survive that final UT if you're not close enough, and then of course, you know, you're gonna fail the time bonus.
Right.
But yeah, just, I mean, you just think how much time you have here on Master Ninja. You have like 6 or so minutes for these encounters. It's crazy.
Oh yeah.
Of course, they give you fiends as well, which is really nice of them. But I think I've mentioned about UT staggering with the Luna before. Actually, I'm 99% sure we have. But with the Luna, you'll notice here that I'm positioning myself a certain way so that when you kill a zombie with the Luna UT, as long as it's on the third or fourth or fifth hit of the Luna UT, you will have enough time to just stand there and charge a UT again. If it's on the first or second hit, then you'll get an ET, but like the essence will come out straight away and you'll just absorb that essence and you won't be able to take it into a UT. So wherever possible, you know, try and stagger your distance so that you're killing them on the third, fourth, or fifth hit, and then they die, you charge your ET, the essence pops out, you immediately get your UT, and it just takes off, you know, 2 seconds of every charge time when you're going for UTs.
Now, can you get 50 UTs / ETs in this encounter?
In this one right here.
Yeah, I mean, because it looks like you've got a lot of ETs, and, you know, I never really kind of played it that way. I just tried to UT my way through it, never thinking, oh, let me get a quick ET, because you know you're not, or I would always think you're not going to, you know, be able to max out on that. But seeing how fast some of those ETs went through, I wonder if between a combination of that, you could.
Maybe, I don't know. The reason I do that, though, is usually when I've staggered the essence. So, for example, what I just mentioned about the kills, when you stagger it and you get that ET, you're only ever really going to get 2 UTs out of a zombie, like, feasibly on normal when they're in groups like that. And that ET, like, letting it rock, and then you absorb an essence immediately, if you didn't do that ET, you'd still have the 2 second charge time, and you'd get 5,000 points. Whereas doing it that way, you're like, the exact same amount of time passes, but instead, you've got 7,000 instead. So,
right.
This is a tricky fight. I still feel like there's something that could be done on this one. The lift is really tricky, just because of the way they spawn. You know, it's really annoying. One thing I mentioned.
They were all in unison there.
Yeah. One thing to note, you saw it there, but if you kill an enemy, if you kill a zombie with an ET, like, you can always just charge up another ET in time for the essence coming out. So you just keep that in mind. Whether it's the first or second hit, it doesn't matter.
Now, I do recommend to people, if they do this and they're not going for score, try to get it to where you have the flails and the guys drop and you can go just fiend sealer before they even get up like 3 times in a row. It's hilarious.
We probably shouldn't say how satisfying that is.
Oh, it's great.
It is a great feeling, though, because zombies, especially, you know, when you first start karma running, zombies will cost you so many time limits because you'll think, oh, I can kill him, I can make the time bonus. And then what kills you is that you see the time bonus go down, and like literally the millisecond it hits 0.00, like, their death animation finishes, and you think, man, I was literally like a tenth of a second off getting that, you know? So right here, I'm running pretty low on time. Being able to consistently do forward Y into forward Y with the Dragon Sword is very, very important. I forgot here, I should have stuck with the flails here. Because of the way they are when they land, you can see 2 hits of that UT don't actually connect, so it doesn't kill him. So if I'd have stuck with the flails, I would have killed that guy. Again, you can still fiend seal them even though they're like almost stood up. This is why you want to grab potency, as it really makes this string right here a lot more powerful. And again, you know, this runs it pretty close. The reason I go out really far to the right there is so Ryu doesn't attack the bloody switch with that flail UT, which easily could have happened. So.
Oh yeah, God, I can't stand that. That's one of those things.
Kill these bats. You don't want to lose a talisman on them. Fun fact, though, I think we did mention it in chapter 5, actually, but if we didn't, I had originally planned to burn a talisman in this chapter intentionally to refill my Nimpo. Unfortunately, ending up how close I actually play this time bonus, I don't have time to do that, so I actually have to burn through quite a few devil elixirs. Fortunately, on normal, you can do that because they give you so many. But for example, on a difficulty above normal, I should have tested that on my practice run. I just kind of thought I'd have the time. It doesn't take long. It takes maybe 7 seconds for me to burn that talisman. I just don't have 7 seconds at the end of this chapter, as you'll see.
Wow, that's crazy.
So I've talked about this pattern before as well, but I'll just reiterate it. Level 2 Dragon Sword on zombies is absolutely perfect for doing this staggering of UTs. And then you can save the last two, you know, to farm a little bit. As again, you have those bloody chains in the middle of the floor.
I wonder when they designed all this. Hey, let's put chains on the floor that'll mess everybody up. Or I wonder if they even looked at it that way.
Maybe they just thought they looked cool. I don't know. But I mean, it really does mess you up, you know? They really can mess up your fights.
Oh, yeah. I can't tell you. Oh, man. Just looking at it makes me sick. I'm going to close my eyes for the rest of this encounter.
So, I mean, you can see here, look, that zombie. Fortunately, the zombies can step over those chains. But the imps tend to have a bit more trouble getting by him. So the reason I tossed the windmill shuriken there is to just reorientate Ryu. As this zombie, look, he actually doesn't move. So if I'd have jumped away, like roll jumped away, that UT would have whiffed. So again, just little things like that. You know, just try and keep it. It's a lot to keep in your head, you know, it really is.
Right.
But just little things like that that can, you know, that can screw you up. And you know, to fail at this point in this gauntlet is... You know, it hurts. You know, you're like, oh, damn it. And I was so close. All I had to do was these guys. And then I would have been okay.
Now, make sure you don't, as you're coming up, you don't look at the guys because they'll start shooting at you.
Yeah, always keep these guys off screen.
Rotate that camera as you're running around the corner.
Yeah. So right here, you don't have to throw that incendiary. You can, if you're feeling a little fruity, you can try and get two UTs out of these last two guys. As you can see, look at that. I've got 8 seconds left. That's a UT guaranteed if you can figure out how to get it. The time is there. I didn't want to do that because this chapter was getting a bit old.
Well, you might have also failed your time bonus, too.
Exactly. Well, actually, I would have. If I'd have spent that 8 seconds, I would have failed it. So there you go. You know, perfect example. So here we go. The Bone Dragon. He's pretty straightforward. The only thing that really is frustrating about the Bone Dragon is he has a lot of like built-in downtime where you just can't do anything, and it's when he's swapping his feet. So I did test this with Armlet of the Sun. I used Armlet of the Sun and Fire Wheels and XXY, and I used Potency and XYY, and Potency by far was the more powerful string. So stick with that, and you'll get the fastest kill bonus, which is very important, as we'll see.
Well, see, that's the other part of it, too. Your time limit was so short to get there, you couldn't even, like, kill the bats to refill your health, son.
It's annoying, because you look at when he swaps his feet, look, and I think it wastes around 4 seconds. That was 64.4, and it's more than 4 seconds, and, like, 56 when I can hit him again. So that right there, him swapping his feet, I can't remember what that points per second was, but that was, like, 10,000 points I just lost just for him swapping his feet. So here's the bitch. With the time I have, if he does that again, where he lifts his foot up, or does his tail whip on his other foot, the time limit's dead. I can't make it. So right here, I'm panicking a little bit. Even though I shouldn't be, because I've got a save. I can just reload the save, but, you know, I just wasn't thinking. So right here, I burn both, when I could have just used the Great Devil Elixir and kept my regular. But again, fortunately, on normal... It's not a big deal, but just keep it in mind. The time limit, as I said, 35:59. So I was very, very close to failing that. But that does it for Chapter 6, guys. I'll leave this bit at the end. You know, this is added on. So again, you know, keep it in mind. Grab your item. Go and save. You know, be really quick. As this is Chapter 7 now. So, you know, this is going to... The clock's already ticking, basically. But I hope you all enjoyed this video. And we'll see you in Chapter 7.
Take care, guys.